Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And
he who dwells in the shelter of the Most High
will abide in the shadow of the Almighty.
I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress,
my God, in whom I trust.
Because you have made the Lord your dwelling place,
the Most High is your refuge.
No evil shall be allowed to befall you.
Thank you.
Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, your mercy attends us all our days. Be our strength and support amid the wearisome changes of this world and in life's end. Grant us your promised rest and the full joys of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
At that time, Jesus declared,
I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things for the wise and understanding and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise be to you, Lord.
But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discerning I will thwart. And Jesus said, I came to cast fire on the earth and wood that it were already kindled. I have a baptism to be baptized with, and how great is my distress until it is accomplished. Do you think that I have come to give peace on earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. All this time, Jesus has preached and taught his disciples the dangers inherent in loving possessions, dangerous distractions, and being a hypocrite. And not only were they, but we too who hear him today, to be watchful of those and a multitude of other sins, but to pay particular attention to the divisions that such sins cause. The division between ourselves and the Lord. After Jesus' ascension, those apostles will become the stewards of the gospel in a time of great division, of another sort entirely. Jesus will light the candle, and from that moment, Christians throughout the world will fan the flames. It's the ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ that generates the fire which destroys and which divides. But fire does more than just destroy and divide. It also refines, it cleanses, it purifies. The fire Jesus comes to cast is its own fiery baptism upon the cross. The cross of Christ will cause division, yes, but it also calls, gathers, enlightens, and sanctifies the whole Christian church on earth, and keeps it with him in the one true faith, as Luther wrote in the Small Catechism, calling us by the gospel to receive the undeserved ability to believe in him and to repent. And in the end, those with the fire of the Holy Spirit will enter everlasting life, and those who do not will spend eternity in quite another kind of fire. The fire which Jesus casts through the apostles and down through the generations by the laying on of hands is the word of truth. Jesus proclaimed, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Here is the great divide. Jesus puts himself in opposition to everything that is not the truth. Everything cannot be true. All opinions cannot be valid. All teachers and preachers are not upright and honest in their teaching. All doctrines cannot be true. Everyone cannot be protected from being offended when their version of the truth is exposed to be false. And this is neither political, nor is it sociological. It is all about salvation. Only Christ brings us the truth about God's eternal kingdom, and the truth about how this life must and should be lived. Can men marry men? Can an unborn child be murdered because it would be inconvenient to the parents at that time? Can we pull the plug on grandma, not because there is no brain function or there is no hope, but merely because he is awful expensive to keep alive? For that matter, can I take my own life just because I'm tired of living it? Won't the church still be here when my kids are done with organized Sunday sports? They need to pad their college resume much more than they need Jesus right now. My little white lies are hurting everyone, especially if I don't get caught. And he needs to get ahead of life. That's okay, isn't it? As long as I don't break the laws of men. The way, the truth, and life says not only no, but hell no. These sins are not okay by any stretch. And now we have division. Because outside of Jesus, there is no peace in this world. Despite what the world may claim is correct, we as the body of Christ are held to another standard. And here's where the world takes offense. And it is beginning to look like it wants to silence the objectionable, the reprehensible truth more than ever before. And here is where we become entrenched in our own struggle. Because at times, the word of truth is offensive to our own ears, despite all that we have been taught. The words of the free forgiveness of sins won by Christ's death and resurrection continue to bring offense and division. But how do we discern what is true and what is false? Look how confusing it can be just to try to follow the news. Some of these websites online look like they are legitimate and professional, but they're fake and they don't have a single true word in them. And such is the way of our society, which unfortunately has always sought to make you put your trust in yourself and your desires. Whatever you want to be the truth is true by virtue of your desire that it be true. Now, academics have a fancy word for that. They call it postmodernism. We have a better word for it. We call it stupid. The writer of the Hebrews aids us in our pursuits of the real truth. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. God knows your heart. He knows the sin that resides in it. And Jesus calls to us and tells us to conform to the image of himself, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers to be saved. Now, this conformation is seemingly an impossible commandment. In ordinary times, when life is easier and more straightforward, we want to enjoy ourselves, and sometimes we put Jesus away until something happens and we need him again. And then in confusing and frightening times, such as we currently live, it's hard not to accept the poison that the world offers as though we were medicine, because it conforms to the shape of our heart. It's hard to deny the truth that we make for ourselves. And it's hard to turn it in for the truth with a capital T, which conforms our heart to the shape of Jesus Christ. But don't be afraid. Don't be discouraged. Hear what St. Paul said as he offended the ears of many with the gospel. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For since it is the wisdom of God, the world did not know God for wisdom. It pleased God, through the folly of what we preach, to save those who believe. Jesus comes to save us from ourselves, from our sinful desires, our failure to see our hearts diseased by a world that hates him. Father, forgive and protect us from your doubt, from doubting your truth. Guard us against succumbing to offense and being frightened of division within our communities, our families, and especially within our own hearts. That we may cling to your truth alone and share it with all. In the name of Jesus, amen. May the peace which passes all understanding guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. enjoy. Open our hearts to rejoice in your coming, so that we may meet you in your word and sacrament for the forgiveness of our sins and the strengthening of our faith. Help us to bless and extol your name before the nations, and to declare your salvation to the generations to come, proclaiming that you are merciful and gracious, and abounding in steadfast love. Our Creator and Lord, from you all things come, to you are all things directed. Provide for our nation faithful leaders who will hear and heed your law. Protect and defend the citizens. Preserve the precious gift of liberty, and inspire us to use our own freedom honorably. Our compassionate Lord, we do not suffer alone the pain and afflictions of this life, but we live them out within your grace and are sustained by your mercy. Hear us on behalf of the sick, those who suffer, the grieving, and those to whom death is near. We especially pray for the Hoffman family, and especially Carol, her sister Linda, who passed away on Friday. We give thanksgiving for Janice Stephens recovering from her broken hip. And we celebrate with the Lord Olivia's Sunday's 14th birthday. And we pray and ask for safe travel for all those who travel this weekend. According to your will, deliver those from their afflictions and give to all your strength, patience, and hope, that they may endure to eternal life. Show compassion and drive all pestilence from our land. Our gentle God and Lord, you have invited us to come to you with the heavy burdens of this life, that we may find rest and peace in your mercy. Grant relief to those who struggle, supply to those in need, hope to those who fear, and peace to those who are anxious, that we may be delivered from all adversity and brought to everlasting life. Heavenly Father and gracious God, as we come to the table your Son has set, grant to us faith and repentance, so that we may receive with joy and thanksgiving his flesh and his bread and his blood and his cup. Grant us your Holy Spirit, that what we have received with our lips we may keep in holiness of life. Lord, in your mercy. All these things, blessed Lord, we pray to you to grant us according to your merciful goodness and for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you. He broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Depart in joy and